took bread, and when he get, when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." This has been the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Communion for me is a very, very special time for more than one reason. And it's just God's will that I get to do it on the first Sunday in September in honor of the two people that taught me what I know most about communion. Both my grandmothers, Sadie Coleman was a Methodist, Amy Zion, deaconess. Madeline Mitchell, my dad's mom, was a Baptist. But both these ladies took communion very, very serious. And on the first Sundays, I was with one or the other of them, either in the Methodist church or the Baptist church, setting up communion. And some of you probably wonder why I stick to those old traditions, so, but there's some things that are put in you that nobody, as both used to say, lye soap can't even wash it out. And those are things that were instilled in me by my grandmothers, that it's reverence. This is a special table. You don't just go up here playing around. You long ago. Now they probably, oh Lord, probably gonna whip me when I get home because I ain't got nothing on my head. I got to wrap my hair this morning. But you didn't go to the communion table without having that little lace handkerchief on your head. You covered your head. But forgive me, Lord. I'll do better the next time. And then about 10, 12 years ago when I started going through COP training, well, when I became a deacon, I carried on, and there were some ladies in this church, Mrs. Duvall, Mrs. Kitchen, especially Mrs. Duvall, if you all remember her. Communion was the most sacred thing to her. She even had a cloth made for Beth Salem's table with Beth Salem on it. I don't know where it is. I wish we could find it. Then they bought the new communion furniture. They made sure the deacons stressed to the elders, before you buy that furniture, you make sure they didn't have those words on. Do this in remembrance of me. And then going on to COP training, we were taught that there are three sacraments in the Presbyterian church or in all churches, but we were being taught the Presbyterian way. The first thing you do is you pray. And this should all, these three things should always be visible to the congregation, to anybody that walk in your church. You start out praying and asking God for forgiveness and to change your life and make you a new creature. And then once God has did that, you go before your session and the minister, and you ask to be baptized. And this is the baptismal font. And it should always help water in that no matter what Sunday somebody walk in your church and ask to be baptized or say, I'm ready, you should be able to take them to the font and sprinkle the water on them. Now in the Methodist church, they sprinkled me. But you know, them two grandmothers was going to have say so because I was the only granddaughter at the time. So I was sprinkled in the Methodist church. Then I was taken over to the Baptist church in that outdoor cement pool, and I was put under and brought back up. And both ministers, the Baptist and the Methodist minister, gave me the right hand of fellowship. So I've walked this journey from stage to stage. And then I got here and got to be an elder. First a deacon, and I could set the table up. And then I got to be an elder, and I could serve those elements. And then I got to be a commissioned lay pastor, and I could preside over this table. And for me, this is my greatest reward as a commissioned lay pastor. I don't care about preaching. I'll preach if I have to, and I have to do it once a year. This is my once a year time. And I'll put it on the records pad that I did my sermon for this year. I get my certificate renewed. But the sacrament, the taking of the sacrament, the taking the sacraments to other people, just being able to say those words means so much to me. So now you know why these things are all here. Communion. In my researching, I learned that communion has a Greek meaning and a Latin meaning. One means sharing, the other one means coming together. And this is what Jesus did with his disciples on that night. He knew he was coming to the end of his journey. Nothing caught him off guard. God prepared him for everything that he was going to go through. He knew what was going to happen the next day. So this was his time to gather together his brothers, his disciples, and have a meal with them. Now, I thought about everybody sitting down having a meal. I thought about how, and last night I had to watch it before I went to sleep. It's a TV show, Blue Blood. I don't know if any of y'all watched that or not. Now, they're Catholic, but they sit down, they have their meal together all the time. And they, just like some of us, it's not always smooth. Now, I know how it is with my group. I've got three or four of them when we all get together. together, they gonna start some mess. Somebody gonna take something off somebody else's plate. Somebody gonna say, oh no, that ain't the way it happened. You know mama didn't let you do that. Or they gonna tell something they wasn't supposed to tell. It's just messy. Messy, messy, messy. And you know what, I'm starting to see that in the grandchildren too. I've been sitting back, but I hear a lot of things they be saying, so, but you know, that's life, times change. This is probably what happened with Jesus at the communion table. All the disciples was there. Everybody wanted to be his favorite. Now see, they say I have a favorite grandchild, but I don't. I love all 24 of them. I don't have a favorite grandchild. I love them all. But they say I got a favorite. And I ain't gonna release that secret. And then they say I got a favorite child. They even call him my daddy. But I don't have a favorite child. They all, I love them all. In their own perspective, in their own walk. They are all different. Even though I have the twin girls, they're totally different. But then they're going to come together when they need to come together. And that's the way the disciples were. They were different. They came from different walks of lives. You had lawyers, you had tax collectors, you had fishermen. And you had people from all different. You get all of this together, and what you got? A holy mess. Jesus had them all there for that last meal. He wanted to talk to them. He wanted to give them his final instructions as to what they were supposed to do after he was gone. Well, you know, there was that one. Could not wait until he got through saying what he had to say, until he said, it's time to eat. There was that one that had to stand up and say something, and the other one pulling it back down. There was that one started singing. It's not time to sing yet. We're supposed to be listening. There was one that probably started praying. Lord, let me pray for all these crazy brothers and men. And then there was that one that dipped in the plate. He couldn't wait for Jesus to finish the prayer. He dipped it in the food before Jesus could even dip. I know that you know what happened at that table, because it happens at our tables at least once or twice a year, Thanksgiving and Christmas. You watch when you get your families together, or any celebration where they all together. It's a mess. But they got through. He finally got them to settle down to do the communion. And he tried to explain to them, this is not just a meal. This is not just a regular meal. Communion is not just a regular meal. Communion is that special supper that you come to. You be nice. You talk nice. And you eat like somebody with some sense. You don't try to eat before, get your plate before everybody else get this, because you're scared that that brother gonna take it all. Well, you know, we got them like that one grandson we got that, you know, he tried to eat everything and get his hands on. People think he does because he's so big, but believe it or not, he doesn't even like it all. He has stepped back and let others go before him. But somebody was afraid that they wasn't gonna get anything. So they started to, you know how we do sometimes when we come for family night? And we start eating, and then Miss Mamie will send Mr. Moses back two or three times to get her Virginia said, well, let me fix me something to take home before I sit down. You know how we do. We do it. And I said, well, I guess I better get Johnny and Baby Carolyn. I said, well, I better fix Tom on a plate. We all do it. It's no secret. We are human. The disciples were human. Jesus was human. And we still have those things going on today. But the Last Supper that it is sometimes called, because that was the last meal he was going to eat with his disciples, was supposed to be a time for them to get instructions, get prepared to complete his work, to continue down that road that he had been traveling on, continuing to do the things for the people that he had done. You never hear about Jesus preaching anywhere. And all the times that he did get together with a big crowd, he taught. He didn't preach. You didn't hear him up there screaming and hollering and, oh, Jesus this and getting out of breath. He taught, he gave his message, and he walked away somewhere by himself to get revived. Because dealing with the big crowd, dealing with a congregation, it takes a lot out of you. I had one of my ministers that was training me say, after all the years that he had been preaching, he preached at one of the big churches here in Columbus. He said he still got butterflies in his stomach when he got up to preach. And he says, if you ever get to the point where you can stand up in front of a group and give a message and you don't get those butterflies, it's time for you to retire. Because God is not in it. Because God's going to always keep you on your toes. You're going to be nervous about making a mistake or missaying something. That's why this morning, I only did 3 by 5 I ain't gonna read no sermon. I'm gonna make sure that I stay within my time frame. So I just wanted you to know why sometimes when you see me come in on first Sundays, and I always try to have on my white or my off-white. I always try to have my head covered. I'm real picky about the table. It's not about me. It's about the Jesus that's in me. This is what he was looking for with his disciples, to carry on the word. And coming around the communion table, so now you know the reason for it, what you should get out of it when you come to the communion table. He always tell the scripture, and until this time when I was researching what I was going to say, we've always read the Matthew and the Luke version of the Last Supper. Did you all know that it's also in 1 Corinthians? 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 26 through 28. It's the first time that it was wrote about. Paul was talking, and Paul wrote about it in the book of Corinthians. And it's not a time that you come together to be greedy. It's not a time that you come together to get full. It's a time you come together to share and to love. You wait on each other to get served. You don't try to eat yours before the preacher gets through going through what they go, whatever they're going to say about the bread and the wine. This is why you are asked to hold your elements until all are served. Because it's a community. It's a sharing. It's something you do together. Not one whenever you get ready to do. You hold them until they say, all are served. So this is the reason you do the things you do during a communion service. You don't, it's just not a ritual. I hope you won't just take it as a ritual. It's not just a Presbyterian thing. Any denomination you go in, they serve communion. They might not serve it the same way. They might not say all the same things, but when you get down to the end of it, to the meat and bread part of it, everybody says the same thing. This bread represents the body of Christ. This cup, wine, or grape juice, whichever they serve, represents the blood of Christ. We can't change that. And what did Christ's body represent? One. That's why we do it all together. He wants us to be on one accord. Be one body. And the blood lets us know. He gave his blood for us. He gave his all. His body. And then they drained the blood from his body to make sure that he didn't come back. Why they drain us of our blood when we pass on to this world and go on to the next one. They're going to take all the blood out of your body before you present to the fight. We don't go to Christ with this human blood in us. When we leave this world, we're not in this body, and we don't carry the blood with us. All we have is the spirit that he gave us. The spirit is what goes up to Christ, or wherever your spirit goes. Everybody might not make it to that top limit. Some of us might not make it no further than the first, the third, the fourth, however many realms there are. And when I see people posting, when somebody passed away, they say, rest in peace, or rest in your heavenly Father's arms. How do you know where they are? I say, rest in the love of your family or whoever you left behind. Those memories they have will be so good that you'll have a peaceful transition to go wherever you go. So that's my thing on communion. If our elders will come forward, now we will practice what I preach. Communities will take communion in a different way. That they won't just do it inside the building. And once they leave those doors, that they will take what that communion represents with them. The love of Jesus Christ is what communion represents. That they will take that love with them and spread it throughout.